May the blessings of the divine always be with us. Thank you, Sai Shruti, for the soulful rendition. We now welcome our dear principal, Mr. Aloysius De Mello, to lead us in prayer. We request you all to stand.
Bless, O Lord, this school and use it in all things according to thy will. May thy presence be ever within its walls. May it stand always for all that is true, noble, lovely, and of good report. Grant that we and others may so gain from its life, that many may bless thee for the day when it was founded, and that its work may be extended and continued for the generations yet to come. We give thee humble and hearty thanks, O most merciful Father, for our founders and for the lives and good example of all who serve thee here. Pour down thy continual blessings, we pray thee, on this school. Make us daily more thankful for and less unworthy of thy many and great mercies. Prosper our labor as thou seest best for us. Protect us, we beseech thee, from all things both hurtful to our souls and to our bodies. Preserve us from sin and selfishness, and in all our work and in all our play, make us generous and brave, obedient and patient, pure and true, that our lives being sanctified by thy love, our days here may be attended by thy blessing. Kindly be seated.
Thank you, sir.
As a token of our appreciation and gratitude, we now request our chairperson and trustees to felicitate our chief guest, Ms. Sudha Murthy, for gracing this occasion and inspiring our students. Portrait of Ms. Sudha Murthy, composed by our art teacher, Mr. Vinayaka. Using the title of all of her works in Kannada and English, it symbolizes the love and admiration our students and staff have for your writing, ma'am. this, we express our gratitude.
We request our principal to felicitate the guests for this evening. Our chairperson, Mr. Bijay Agarwal, a visionary who has always been an inspiration and a motivational force, taking the school to greater heights. Thank you, sir.
Our director, Mrs. Neeru Agarwal, who has provided a new dimension to the growth of the school with her commitment, creativity, and new initiatives. Thank you, ma'am.
Our trustee, Mr. Manas Mehrotra, who has always brought in new initiatives and provided timely advice. Thank you, sir.
Our trustee, Mr. Jagannath Subbarao, who has been with us through all activities and supported us. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Our trustee, Mr. P.K. Mishra, who has supervised and taken care of all developmental projects and provided support. Thank you, sir.
Respected principal of Greenwood High Banargata campus, Mr. Louis Dias, who has graced this occasion with his presence. Thank you, sir.
Our dear vice principal of Greenwood High Sarjapur ICSE campus, Mrs. Elizabeth Joseph, who has encouraged and supported us in every endeavor from across the campus. Thank you, ma'am.
We also welcome Mr. and Mrs. Parekh, our special guests. Thank you for being with us. A big thanks to all our guests and dignitaries for gracing this occasion. A warm welcome to the parent community and the guests of the graduating students.
Let us now enjoy a spirited performance by our Greenwood High students as they express through dance the essence of the theme Beyond Boundaries.
Seconds, hours, so many days. You know what you want, but I'm locking you away. Every moment lasts forever. Then you feel you lost your way. And what if my chances were already gone? I started believing that I could be wrong. But you gave me one good reason to fight and never walk away. So here I am. Escape. is gonna bring me down. I've jumped every bridge and I've run every line. I've risked being safe, but I always knew why. I always knew why. With every step you climb another mountain, every breath is harder to release.
Thank you for this mesmerizing performance, which captivated the spirit of the theme Beyond Boundaries perfectly and gracefully.
Greenwood High has always been supportive of its students, recognized their abilities, and provided several platforms to flourish. It is time for us to recognize a few special achievements of students from the graduating class through special awards.
We request our esteemed members of the board, Mrs. Neeru Agarwal and Mr. Manas Mehrotra, to give away these special awards. We request our IBDP coordinator, Ms. Kavya S., to kindly announce the names of the awardees with the citation.
Good evening, everyone. The first special award for this evening goes to the valedictorian of the class of 2023, Satviki Shankaran, for achieving the highest grade in the preparatory examination. Congratulations, Satviki. The award for the salutatorian of the class of 2023 goes to Pritika Agarwal. Pritika is the second highest ranking student in the preparatory examinations. We now move on to the Learner Profile Award. This award is given to students who display attributes of inquirers, knowledgeable, thinkers, communicators, principal, open-minded, caring, risk-takers, balanced, and reflective. This year, the two recipients of this award, Kalpita Nath and Satviki Shankaran. Congratulations, Kalpita. Congratulations, Satviki. The the highest achievement award is given to those students who have well-round achievement in relation to attendance, respect for others, contribution to school events and activities. This year, the recipient of this award has successfully progressed in her IB journey, maintaining the rigorous deadlines patiently, always with a smile on her face. She has also been an integral part of various school events from Ignite to Syntax. And the award goes to Pritika Agarwal. Congratulations, Pritika. The next special award recognizes the effort the students have put in academics and other fields. This year, the award goes to two students who have been backbone of the school events like Model United Nations, Ignite, and several other activities and have always been leading from the front. And the award goes to Tesu Agarwal and Nitya Ganapati. Congratulations, Tesu. Congratulations, Nitya. The last award for the evening is one which is very dear to us. This is the Exemplary Service Award given to students who have made significant contributions to their community through their time, action, talent, and dedication. For the class of 2023, the recipient of this award has spearheaded the social service club in school and is the proud recipient of the prestigious Dina Award. And that's none other than our ex-school captain, Shloka Ashok. Congratulations, Shloka.
Thank you, Mrs. Agarwal, Mr. Mehrotra, and Ms. Kavya.
It is our pleasure to invite our valedictorian from the class of 2023, Satviki Shankaran, to speak about her experiences at Greenwood High and to share her thoughts on this significant day.
A very good evening to our respected principals, vice principals, chief guest, teachers, and my fellow classmates. My name is Satviki Shankaran, and I am your valedictorian for the class of 2023. Class of 2023, how far have we come? Today is the day we have counted towards since our primary years. It was yesterday that 11-year-old Satviki Shankaran stood at her primary school graduating from grade 5 to 6, thinking about how far the end of school lies. Time flew by, and here we are. Looking back, it seemed exciting to no longer be conformed to grades, timetables, single-form lines, or uniforms. But now, while this occasion brings an overwhelming sense of gratitude and nostalgia, it hints at a tinge of sadness that I will have to leave behind the endless classrooms and corridors, where I have made a lifetime of memories, founded lifelong friendships, and learned necessary life lessons in the last 2 years I've spent at Greenwood High. Looking back, in other words, reflections, a word we have commonly associated with last-minute CAS experiences. Nonetheless, as I reflect upon the last 2 years, I realize that my most cherished memories are not ones that have defined my college applications, but the fonder recollections that I've shared with my classmates. These memories are sprinting between school buildings during Ignite, taking meandering walks in the corridors, shout out to the salutatorian for this one, winning tug of wars as a proud Sophia student, dealing under rejected IA topics, receiving deadline emails, or dancing shoulder to shoulder at the end of every school event. I must tell you that the batch of 2023 truly loves to dance. In the midst of these unforgettable times, I must commend the resilience of a batch to not only reimagine old traditions that were shut down abruptly by the global pandemic, but also the sheer capability to create new ones, to carve our own identity and leave a mark as we graduate. When we reflect, it is also imperative to acknowledge those who have guided us through somber, defeating times of our lives. Thank you to my parents for always supporting me and, most importantly, scolding me when I failed to believe in my own capability. Thank you to my siblings for being my source of light. And yes, we fight, and I must admit, sometimes you are right. Thank you to my nani for making me who I am. I hope that wherever you are, you're proud of me here and now. Thank you to my friends for being my support system, the crowd for my bad jokes, and my best co-writers. I would ask for no one else. Thank you to my teachers for making me fall in love with knowledge and never getting tired of me barging into your free lessons with queries. I will never be able to thank you in words of you. Lastly, thank you, Greenwood High, for being the setting to my greatest achievements, most eloquent poetry recitations, and my fondest memories. Endings are hard of this speech and of the school life. However, when things come to end, it is best to recall the threads that have woven the story together. And for me, it's been poetry, and here it goes. I bid farewell all too soon. I hoped that for once, the merciless time waited too. I stand at the brink of a fall with no end. I don't know what to tell you without some level of confident pretense. For I am also a traveler in these lands anew, unknown, daunting, but exuberant too. But if I were to say words of you, remember in your choices lies your fate. Know that life as a moving stream may not be a carefully constructed dream. In times of an unfriendly strife, remember to be free or fight with all your might. Whisper kindness to the winds, trees, and terns, hoping that life never becomes your nemesis, but muse for once. I bid farewell all too soon. Leaving memories, I hope you treasure teaching the same books, arguing the same problems, running behind the same deadlines, or when you find the same names with different faces too. Lars, I don't have much more to say. For there will be long days without you, my friends, and I will tell you all about it when I see you again. We have come a long way from where we began, and I will tell you all about it when I see you again. Class of 2023, be brave and be kind. Signing off, your valedictorian, Satviki Shankaran. Thank you.
Thank you, Satviki, for those moving words. We will remember you with pride, always.
We now invite our class salutatorian, Pritika Agarwal, to share her experience and thoughts on this memorable day.
A very good evening to the respected principal, vice principal, our esteemed chief guest, parents, and my dear friends. Class of 2023, we made it. Pushed to the demanding online classes, rolled our eyes when we were told there would be no portions cut, even cried when we learned of IB's unforgiving nature when grading our exam papers, but we made it. It is an honor to stand here today because my journey to this point has been nothing short of a roller coaster. Chaotic, dizzying, adventurous, memorable, and perhaps even thrilling. I still remember the night before my first day. As afraid as I was, it went something like this. Mirror, mirror on the wall, am I good enough to fit in with them all? An unsettling new task was sent my way, grade 11, they say. They brought me their crystal dome and asked me to peep at my new home. State-of-the-art architecture, polished and elegant uniforms, chirping voices each morning, oh my, a stunning school indeed, I confessed. On the outside, I was a Krispy Kreme sprinkle donut, brimming with passion and excitement and vibrancy. But on the inside, oh dear, like a snail without its shell, forced to fight warriors on a battlefield. A salty droplet of sweat rolled along the edges of my forehead. All of a sudden, a scrambled frenzy shook my forehead. Was I fearless enough to strike up conversations with them? Was I persistent enough to make a name for myself? Was I friendly enough to kindle a flame of new friendship? Was I brave enough to face them all? When I shifted to Greenwood High, I had just one mission, to survive. But now that I think about it, it wasn't just my mission. It was our mission, finding ourselves, building ourselves from a nobody to a somebody. That was our goal. From constant decision-making to chasing deadlines and reading instructions in bold red letters. From excelling at academics to building stellar profiles for our dream schools, IBDP had taken a toll on all of us. I still remember those days when we would freestyle to upbeat music because we were in desperate need of a breather. It was in moments like those that I realized why reflection always remained in the spotlight of the IB learner profile. Without the support of the five pillars in my life, I wouldn't be standing here today. My parents, the first pillar who taught me the importance of chasing excellence and happiness rather than success. They always inspired me with stories of their role models, never realizing that the person I most wanted to be was them. Thank you, Mom and Dad. Thank you to my younger brother, the second pillar, from whom I learned to embrace harsh criticism. The third pillar, a furry little monster, my cat, whose constant purring reminded me that the haters are gonna hate, but I just need to shake it off. So thank you, and I'm sorry we couldn't get you a ticket tonight. Thank you to my friends, the fourth pillar, without whom form lessons and lunch breaks wouldn't bear that spark of joy, and a special shout out to the valedictorian here. Lastly, the fifth pillar, Greenwood High, a place I now call my second home. Thank you to my teachers for constantly supporting me in these last 2 years, encouraging me to speak in class to help me overcome my fear of public speaking, and for shaping me into the person that I am today. A special thank you to my counselor for answering my never-ending questions and waving at me with a warm smile and every time I walk past the counselor's office. Class of 2023, today we stand here together, feel proud and filled with immense gratitude towards our own pillars for helping us through this beautiful journey, waiting to receive our diploma and turn our tassels. Before we bid farewell to these nostalgic school memories and embark on our chosen journeys, don't ever forget that you are unique. Never forget that you are the artist of your own dreams, so don't ever hand the paintbrush to anyone else or compare yourself to somebody else. During this journey of self-discovery, I've also realized that giving up is a breeding ground for regrets. So no matter how many times you fall, pick yourself up, dust yourself, give yourself a pat on the back, and try again and again and again until you reach your destination, because what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. So stand a little taller and embrace the endless opportunities life will give you. Always be passionate and optimistic. Carry a smile with you wherever you go, and enjoy every adventure life has in store for you. The moment is yours, and the world is yours to conquer. Class of 2023, we're just getting started. Thank you.
Thank you, Prithika, for those beautiful words.
The school choir will now render a lyrical and soulful performance of the song For Good, written by Stephen Schwartz.
Said that people come into our
We now request our principal, Mr. Aloysius DeMello, to address the graduating batch.
Good evening to our chief guest, Mrs. Sudha Murthy, Indian educator, author, philanthropist, chairperson of the Infosys Foundation. To our chairman, Mr. Bedja Agarwal, to the board of trustees, Mrs. Neeru Agarwal, Mr. Manas Mehrotra, Mr. Jagannath Subbarao, Ms. Adrija Agarwal in absentia, and Mr. P.K. Mishra. The staff of Greenwood High, parents, well-wishers, and to another great batch, the graduating students of May 2023. We have moved through many teams over the years of this well-established institution, and each team suggests itself by the interests of the time and its troubles and concerns. This year, there are many things that have given rise to this team beyond boundaries. However, the nearest suggestion must come from closest home, from education. The world of education and of work has begun to dissolve many long-held and auspiciously regarded boundaries that we have unfortunately constructed for ourselves. We hear every day of more interdisciplinary, more demands for engineers who can communicate well or think creatively or who read literature. Even books now, we have even books now by scientists who are interested in mythology and folklore. Perhaps to make a beginning in helping us to understand the nature of boundaries we construct for ourselves, I'd like to narrate to you a light incident that might bring a smile on your face. A teacher in the primary school years went to her classroom after the morning interval to find that her students had just returned from a quick game of catching cook. I don't know how many remember how to play catching cook. And had switched off on the fan to cool off. The month was December, the temperature very cold. The teacher asked the students to switch off the fans as she was feeling cold. One of the bolder boys, they would be boys, said that they were warm and wanted it on. The teacher told them politely again that it was because they had come from the playing field and she had not. To this, the boy replied in immediate and complete innocence, asking the teacher, "What stopped you, miss, and the other teachers from playing during the interval?" It's not without reason that the saying goes, "Out of the mouth of babes comes great wisdom." This anecdote helps me distinguish between two types of boundaries. The boundary visible here are the ones created by the force of custom and social conditions. They usually don't stand up to reason, and their proponents reference only long-standing customs to perpetuate them. These are hard to dissolve because society stands in their way and they does not disappear to access to reasoned arguments since they were never based on reason. I ask you to think back and reflect on the boundaries of this nature in your lives. What do they keep you from? What keeps you from going beyond them? Let me delve into a little story of our honorable chief guest. Hailing from a middle-class family, Mrs. Murthy finished school and was expected to follow the path of any other Indian woman, having a basic higher education and then getting married. Most of her peers sought liberal arts, but Mrs. Murthy broke the boundary and opted for engineering. Her father, being a doctor, asked her why she wanted to be an engineer, and she said, and I quote, "I told him that I always believed that humankind progresses with applied science, and applied science can change our life, and that's why she needed to study engineering." She proved absolutely correct. She went on, ladies and gentlemen, to 4 years of studying engineering and found things very difficult. No boys would talk to her. No one would share their notes with her. When she topped the class during her tenure in the engineering college, she recalls, "Who says engineering is a man's domain. Knowledge is no gender bias, no gender domain. It's a seeker's domain. What have you to lose, and more importantly, what have you to gain? These boundaries always have the tendency to morph into prejudices and inflict the biggest loss one can imagine on a human being. It keeps us from forming many relationships as we can in our brief journey through life. And we all know that once prejudices harden, they can be very hard to eradicate. Those who are able to break boundaries of social customs usually fall into the dramatic mold of breakthroughs. It's here that we often see traditionally marginalized groups of people going beyond boundaries and making a difference to themselves. But it is most often the case to a wider community. Take, for instance, Renuka Singh. I would like to hazard a guess here that there are not many people in this audience who know much about her. She is a member of the Indian women's cricket team. While I present this story to you, I'd like you to cross off the number of boundaries that she has gone beyond, beginning with her being a woman playing cricket. Renuka was born in a remote village in the hills of Himachal Pradesh called Parsa, which is in the Rohu subdivision, about 110 kilometers from Shimla. Her father died when she was 3 years old, leaving the family without its primary breadwinner. But I don't want to present this story solely as one of a struggle against odds, which it is, but to highlight the number of boundaries that she and her family went beyond. To begin with, cricket facilities are not the most abundant in a village, and that too in a remote village in the hills. And while some have automatically thought that her gender bound her to resigning herself to a supportive role to the family, it was her mother who encouraged her to pursue the sport that she showed most love for. Here we have the clear dissolution of a social boundary by this cricketer's mother, who could easily have followed the custom. With this, I turn to you to ask you about your thoughts about the number of boundaries built by custom that we endorse and use as a milestone to keep us from rising up and going beyond them. Given that we have the best facilities in Bangalore, and indeed in this great school, Greenwood High, what are the boundaries that have come in your way of achieving success? My advice to you as a graduate, it is to win the first battle against these boundaries by becoming aware of them. It's easier to plan for an opponent that one can see rather than one we deliberately blindfold ourselves to. I'd like to turn your attention to the second type of boundary, which are harder, clearer boundaries that appear to have good reason for being there. They are often set up for convenience and ease of navigation, but we never intended to restrict and dominate. As a student of the IB diploma program, you will immediately recognize how the IB has taken cognizance of this idea of boundaries in at least two of the theory of knowledge prescribed titles that were given to this batch of 2023. I would like to remind you, I know you don't like to remember, but I'd like to remind you, and I know that many of you have attempted these very questions. The IB asked you to consider how the methodologies one uses might determine the knowledge we produce. In other words, do our very methodologies act as boundaries on the knowledge we are able to create? How does changing the methodology open an access to new knowledge? The other title that brought this idea home was the one that asked you to consider whether it mattered if the acquisition of knowledge happened in bubbles with the exclusion of a few voices and information. Again, we see how there is a suggestion about boundaries suggesting exclusion and the implication of such exclusion for knowledge. It is for this reason that IB encourages us to be internationally minded, where we welcome people from beyond our bubble and are stronger in knowledge and relationship from this open collaboration. Many years ago, a great Austrian philosopher, Karl Popper, proposed the idea of an open society, a place where not just an individual, but an entire society was unified by the idea of going beyond boundaries. Indeed, Popper considered democracy as the only place where reform can take place and where leadership change can take place without the need of bloodshed or violent revolution. We see how the notion of democracy contains the idea of going beyond boundaries. This brings me to the most important part of my graduating messages. Here it comes at a particularly opportune moment when we see how democracy was considered by Popper. The part I mean with regard to our great nation, the greatest democracy in the world that has survived against all odds when people thought it would be a failed experiment. India has proven that one might go beyond boundaries of religion, class, caste, or any other boundary you might imagine in order to come together and govern by peaceful means. I would like each one of you to take as your mission the building of India and Indian democracy from wherever you are situated. Greenwood High has time and again, time after time, distinguished itself by the very nature of the education it offers. The chance for students to extend and develop themselves in a manner where they become better versions of their old selves. The education you have received has clearly gone beyond knowledge and skills into the difficult realms of attitude and disposition. Notice how in conquering boundaries, knowledge and skill are necessary, but are not sufficient. It is the right disposition that matters for us to draw strength from our knowledge and skills. Greenwood High has inculcated this in you, and we ask you to remember your alma mater with love and return in the future with tales of your great achievements. The education did not take place by chance. It was a combined effort of teachers, the wider staff, the management of the school, who came together to plan a great future for each one of you, and to give you the independence to go into the world and negotiate its various boundaries with the great transfer skills that you have developed. Your teachers will feel proud at every instance where you go beyond the boundaries and would love to hear from you about these milestones in your life. I also ask you to acknowledge this evening a major source of support in your life, your parents, and the other members of your family, and in many cases, close friends and well-wishers. It's often the case that they have sacrificed much to give you a chance at your potential. And it will be a pity for us to fall below our intentions after such love and sacrifice. One way you can respond to the great support system of the family that we enjoy in India is to pursue your dream and rise to the level of achievement just like Renuka Singh did from a small village in Himachal Pradesh. I like to bring to closure the many ideas that I have presented to you by drawing what I hope to be an insightful connection between boundaries and goals. It does not require much effort to do a quick change of perspective exercise when we are faced with what we regard as a boundary. Don't see a boundary as a limit. Instead, use it to define a goal for yourself. This way, you will turn every boundary into a goal, and by being goal-focused, will take you through the fulfilling life to an area beyond the boundary simply because you regarded it as a goal. Practice the art of changing the perspective and see how you will engage with the world in an impactful manner. When you have a small apartment, think that it is easy to clean. When you have a long journey every day, see this as an opportunity to read or to listen to music. When you have to travel away from your family, which many of you will, see how it is an opportunity to meet new people. And finally, when you think of those IB deadlines, oh God, they were a part of your life so far, but had you just thought that they were simply dates on a calendar, life would have been more interesting for you. I close with good wishes for your well-being and for a brilliant career ahead of you. Greenwood High has brought you to the gate of this wide world. Move into it, paint on this, and don't stop painting. May you always remain rooted in knowledge. Good luck and God bless you.
Thank you, sir, for allowing us to change our goals into boundaries. Boundaries into goals. Sorry. Apologies. Thank you, sir, for allowing us to change our...
Boundaries into goals.
Sorry, sir. Apologies. Thank you, sir, for allowing us to change our boundaries into goals.
In this journey of education for life, the parents and family of our graduating students have always been active and supportive participants. Parents have been their constant source of inspiration and motivation throughout their academic and personal growth.
As a representative of our parent body, our partners in education, we now invite Ms. Shweta Rani, parent of our valedictorian, Satviki Shankaran, to share her thoughts and experiences on this special occasion.
Good evening, everyone. Respected Sudha ma'am, dignitaries, principal and vice principal, sir, teachers, parents, and my dear students. It's my pleasure and true honor to have the opportunity to share my thoughts on this wonderful day. Graduation day. These two words makes all of us emotional. As parents, this moment brings us utmost happiness and pride. We could not be any prouder of you than we are today. We all have been blessed by the opportunity to watch you grow into incredible human beings. So congratulations to the graduating batch of 2023. Your parents and families who are celebrating with you today and will cheer you to your next steps. Good luck for what commences now, what Greenwood High has helped you prepare for. Our empowering principal and vice principal, sir, who have great vision which students bring to life, and our dedicated teachers who help you thrive and enjoy the adventures of learning. Your future is just beginning, and we cannot wait to see you all succeed. We know you are well prepared and dedicated to your dreams. But as a parent, I would like to share what has worked for me in my life thus far. Have you realized that the longest distance between two points is shortcut? So be willing to work hard, get your hands dirty, and brave enough to see sorry, to say sorry if needed. Show gratitude to all the people who have gotten you where you are today. But sometimes, your life may not follow the plans that you have made out for yourself. So be prepared for successes and lows. Celebrate your highs, but ask for help during your lows. Remember, life is made up of small journeys, and you should strive to make them enjoyable, interesting, and as rewarding as possible. It's cool that all of you are going to good colleges. You have plans to become doctor, engineer, scientist, artist, and make some decent money. But you know what is cooler? Is treating every person you interact in your journey with respect, love, and kindness. So be kind, be kind, be kind. Kindness is not a weakness, it's an ultimate strength. We want you to be the generation which makes kindness and positivity your mantra of life. We need more words of encouragement out of you, words that build others up. My final advice to you before you launch: being kind does not mean you cannot be competitive, that you cannot be strong in your values and firm in your conviction. Lean into and develop a competitive mindset. There's nothing as valuable as having the right mindset. So, dear students, take challenges, dive on the floor, scrape your knees, but get up and get going. Here's wishing you the very best for your future endeavors, and may you all be blessed with wisdom, success, and happiness. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am, for those inspiring words.
The school choir will now regale us with a melodious rendition of the song, The Rhythm of Life, written by Dorothy Fields.
Started down the street last Sunday, feeling mighty low and kind of mean. Suddenly a voice said, go forth, neighbor, spread the picture on a wider screen. And the voice said, neighbor, there's a million reasons why you should be glad in all four seasons. In the road, neighbor, leave your worries and strife. Spread the religion of the rhythm of life, for the rhythm of life is a powerful beat. Puts a tingle in your fingers and a tingle in your feet. Rhythm on the inside, rhythm on the street, and the rhythm of life is a powerful beat. For the rhythm of life is a powerful beat. Walkie-talkie to Rocky Ridge, all the way to Canton, then to Scranton, even tell it under the Manhattan Bridge. You will make a new sensation, have a growing congregation, build a glowing operation here below. Like a pipe, piper blowing, lead and keep the music flowing, keep the rhythm go, go, going, go, go, go. You will make a new sensation, have a growing congregation, build a glowing operation. Like a pipe, piper blowing, operation here below, go, go. You will make a new sensation, have a growing operation, build a glowing operation. Fly up high, fly, fly, fly up high. You can do it
Principal, Mr. Nishant Nagavar, to introduce our chief guest before she addresses our graduating class and provides her invaluable advice.
Ms. Sudhamurthy needs no formal introduction. However, mere insight into her life can inspire any student or adult over here at all times. That's the reason we have this introduction. Ms. Murthy has been a renowned writer, educator, entrepreneur, engineer, philanthropist, and the list goes on, and an amazing artist. She's a household name in India, symbolizing what best India represents and aspires to in relation to beliefs and practices, with an exceptional combination of the traditional and modern. While she has crossed several obstacles to be successful, with the grit and determination, she has also championed and showcased some of the best Indian practices with humility and simplicity in a public and personal life. Ms. Sudhamurthy was born in 1951 in Shigaon of present Haveri district in Karnataka. Her father, a surgeon, and mother, a school teacher, supported Ms. Murthy and her siblings by giving them the biggest gift of all, good education. Ms. Sudha Kulkarni, her maiden name then, went on to earn a bachelor's degree in electricals and electronics engineering from BVB College and master's degree in computer science from the Indian Institute of Sciences. Her brother, Mr. Srinivas Kulkarni, is an astrophysicist at Caltech. Her sister, Ms. Jayashree Deshpande, supported the founding of the Deshpande Center at the MIT School of Engineering in the US. Ms. Murthy has founded the Murthy Classical Library of India at Harvard University. I read this because our students find them very impressive. While all the students here would admire, thank you, they would admire the prolific academic contributions and achievements mentioned above by the Kulkarni siblings, it is the work done in the social sector that would truly amaze. While the passion for education drove Ms. Sudhamurthy to take up teaching in several colleges, it's a compassion that played a significant role in setting up thousands of libraries across government schools, supporting basic education requirements for the underprivileged lives, and building more than 16,000 toilets for better hygiene, much, much before the awareness about it was propelled. By spending hundreds of crores of rupees on health, education, culture, disaster management, and other important concerns in a position as the director of the Infosys Foundation, and later as the founder of Murthy Foundation, Ms. Murthy spreads the message of empathy and service as a good ambassador. Ms. Murthy has been an amazing writer. Her simple, honest, and impactful storytelling has earned her the informal title as India's grandmother. Among many little children, who are her biggest admirers. Her autographed books sold like hot dosas this morning at our school in a few minutes, holding a testimony to approachable and adorable writing. Ms. Murthy has authored several books for children and adults in both fiction and non-fiction, covering very important issues, values, personalities, and places. That should be part of your summer reading list. Ms. Murthy is much celebrated for a risky and compassionate, now legendary decision of lending 10,000 rupees out of a hard-earned 10,250 rupees to her husband, Mr. N.R. Narayan Murthy, in 1981, as the angel investor of Infosys Foundation. The market capitalization of the company is now more than a whopping $80 billion. However, what is more important to us is the rationale behind such decisions. She says, regret is worse than failure. Ms. Murthy has thousands of simple anecdotes from her life, which are always helpful to us as students. Whether she being the only female engineering student in a college and eventually acing it, with all oppositions, including no toilet for girls at that time. And also, the first female employee at Telco challenging the restrictions put on women joining male-dominated sectors. Those days, she didn't have an opportunity to apply, but she wrote a letter, which is another story. Her life is full of challenges she faced and how she overcame them. It's also about her learnings from common people, whether they were the Devadasis or eminent scientists like late Mr. APJ Abdul Kalam, Mr. J.R.D. Tata, or children including her own. Ms. Sudha Murthy was conferred with Padma Shri Award in 2006, and as you know, recently with the Padma Bhushan in 2023 by the President of India. It's a big honor. She's also been conferred with several prestigious literary awards, including the Atima Bey Award for her contribution to Kannada and English literature. It's a privilege to have her with us. Thank you, ma'am.
Ms. Murthy, we humbly request you to deliver the special address for this evening.
Good evening to everyone, my dear teachers, parents, and students. I always tell first teachers because I belong to that category. That's the reason. Pushing beyond boundaries, I think I've done a lot of times in life. You know, very first time when I did, I was just recollecting when they were talking about it. I bobbed my hair. It is not a great thing today, but 60 years back, I cut my hair and it became my home address, you know. Where is Dr. Kulkarni's house? Oh, that girl who has bobbed her hair, third from the left. And my father asked me, why did you cut your hair? I said, it's my individual decision and I feel in summer it's easy for me to maintain. And the second thing is, as long as if it is legally, ethically right, I think I should not worry about what people talk. I will have my hair very short. And that, I think, was the first decision in my life. I pushed all the customs in a Hubli middle-class Brahmin family, cutting your hair, and which became my postal address. It is not purposely I wanted to push. Because my mind said, if I do something wrong, you know, stealing someone's money, talking ill of someone, making and becoming a judgmental, then why should I be afraid? That is a mindset, I think, which always pushes me beyond the boundary. When I decided to do engineering, actually you can make a movie on that, I feel. My grandfather was a school teacher, history teacher. He said, better don't do this. Engineering, it is meant for boys. You should not do. What you should do is, he baptized me at the age of 12, age of 8 into history. At the age of 12, I knew Karnataka history. Age of 18, I knew India's history. At the age of 21, I knew world's history. He baptized me very well. He said, you continue your PhD in history. You'll be a good historian, archaeologist. Forget this man's domain, engineering. My mother was a school teacher. She said, you should do MSc mathematics because I was good in math. And she, you know, you can have your family life and teaching together because every teacher gets 2 months leave. So it becomes easy to manage the house. My father was a doctor. He said, you connect with people. So best is you should become a lady doctor, MBBS lady doctor. My buas or atte, they said, if you become an engineer, nobody will marry in our community. You will go and marry someone out of the community and we are not coming for the marriage. Many people were worried about my marriage because my grandmother said, who will marry a lady engineer? They did not know there existed Narayan Murthy across the river. Neither I knew. But I always felt when there was so much tremendous pressure on a girl of 16 and a half, I don't know how I could withstood all those things. But I knew one thing clear, people will talk. People will give you many times advices, according to them, they are right. But what your passion says, what your mind says, and what brings you happiness in life, as long as it's legally, ethically right, you should do that. And I have always done that throughout my 72 years of my life. By the way, I'm not born in 1951, I'm born in 1950. Okay, you reduce my 1 year. You know, I'm younger by 1 year according to you. So, that is the courage I had, and I continue to have, that if I want to do something which is good for me, good for the society, good for the nation, let me do it now. I pass this life only once. I'm not a philosopher. I really don't understand dvaita, advaita, this, that, nothing I understand. But I only know I pass this life only once. If I can show courage, compassion, confidence, with my hard work, let me do it now. If there's another life, I don't know, I may be born as a donkey. I do not know, I will not have a choice except that, you know, somebody will beat me, I have to keep quiet. When I walk this life only once, let me do it good things in this life. When I went to engineering college, boys looked at me like a new animal in the zoo. They were not used to having girls in the class. Teachers felt, she won't sustain engineering subject. They are very tough. And it was in 1968. Imagine your parents were also not born at that time, I suppose. So there were movies like Dhool Ka Phool or Mai Chup Rahungi kind of Hindi movies. Sau saal pehle mujhe tumse pyar tha. Aaj bhi hai aur kal bhi rahega. Or Mang ke saath tumhara mang liya sansar. That was the atmosphere. So my teachers felt whether this girl will be able to continue engineering domain or she will run away with another boy and marry and live happily ever after. College thought building a toilet is a waste of money because anyway she won't be able to sustain more than 3 months in engineering. There are so many oppositions, but I told myself, I have to prove that knowledge is nobody's, it is not gender biased. It is nobody's domain, it's a seeker's domain. And I love knowledge, I'm pursuing knowledge. I'll put my everything, my time, my hard work, no page unturned, that kind of a hard work I will do. And prove for the next generation or next girl who gets into engineering college that I should pave the path much better than what I have. Today, when I go back to my college, I see 30% of the, in instrumentation, 30% are boys and 70% are girls. I tell girls, look after the minority people. Okay? I know what it is to be like that. Why I'm telling you youngsters like you people, it is the mind which decides, oh, I can't do. I can't do. Actually, when I saw the watch, I was surprised that I got only 20 minutes because being a teacher, until next bell rings, I may talk. So good, you gave me only 20 minutes. Children, I want to tell you, it is your mindset and mind. As long as you can recognize your passion and work for it, whether you achieve success or not is a different story. But you will not have regret. And when you grow old like me, turn back in your life and see, you will not have any regrets. Your life is full of satisfaction. After joining 50 years back, I joined Telco 50 years back. After 50 years, last week, I was in Telco Pune, which is known as the Tata Motors. I went to the assembly wing, car assembly wing, and there were 300 girls and no boys. Entire assembly is done by women. I became very emotional and started crying. They said, why are you crying? I said, I remembered my father. Parents, please understand that supporting your children is the biggest strength in life. Many times you may not believe in that, but you have to support. Like my father never believed that I'll do engineering. But he said, the girl wants to do, let me stand with her. There are many advisors to my father. Doctor Saab, your girl does not have brain, that is proven. She's a foolish teenager, proven. But Doctor Saab, you should have brain. You are sending your daughter to man's domain. Is it ever possible black will become white? A donkey will become a horse? A day will become a night? Just don't send her there. You will regret because you have two more daughters to be married off and nobody will marry her. Them. Poor my father stood and told, no, I'll be with her and will help her as much as possible, but ultimately she has to study. I remembered my father who is no more. I said, because you stood with me in difficult times, that was my strength. He never imagined I would make a lot of money. You know, never even I imagined. When I got married to Narayan Murthy, he was unemployed youth. But I had faith in him. When he started Infosys, not foundation, Infosys company, everyone said, don't give 10,000 rupees. This fellow is an idealist. He will not build the company. It won't happen that easily. You are not Tata's or Birla's. You don't have money. So how can you build a company with 10,000 rupees? I said, I may not become rich in life. I'm assuming 10,000 is gone. But I want to support my husband in his dream. When you do your work with passion, with support, not that I knew this before, I knew you will fail, I knew you are not good at it. Never use such words. I'm very much against telling such things to anybody. I knew that you will fail. If you knew, then you are a soothsayer. Okay? Don't ever do that. Even the child fails, if the child doesn't do well in the exam, that is not life. Life is like a full thali meal. Good academics. I don't tell the first rank. You know? I got a first rank, but I never insisted my children should get a first rank. It is not hereditary. Only diseases are hereditary. Nothing is hereditary in life. I told my children, compete in life. Compete in life with yourself, not with your friends, not with your neighbors. Many parents I have seen, look at neighbor's daughter. She has scored 99. This poor boy has scored 97. You are not enjoying his 97. You are worried about your neighbor's daughter, 99. Don't do that. You compete with yourself. Last time, I did X amount of work. This year I will do 2X amount of work. Last year I was not good in English. This year I will be better in English. Compete with yourself. And that makes you a better person. Don't get scared of failures. I was never scared of failures. What will happen? Will you die or what with failures? Nobody will die. I must have read in a WhatsApp, Virat Kohli was not good in mathematics, but he was good to count his number of runs. Dorothy, a Nobel laureate, was a very short lady. She got my Nobel Prize in crystallography when I was a student. And when I looked at Dorothy, I felt this way. She was so short, but she was tall enough to bag the Nobel Prize. Please remember those things, that you will not do well. Academics is the only thing. You get a first rank, your life is made. No, your life is made in many ways. Life is like a full thali. You go to a hotel, I always buy thali because no decision making in that. Otherwise, you want side dish, front dish, back dish, I won't know all those things. So then order thali, everything you'll get. It has many katoris, rice, chapati or puri, sabji and dal, a dessert, one yogurt dish. And they are also not big quantity, they are in small quantity. When you eat, it's a balanced full meal. Life is like that. You should have good academics. That is maybe a rice or maybe chapati. You should be compassionate, they're like a dal. You should work in a team. It is like a dahi or yogurt dish. You should be good with everyone. It's a dessert. So you should be extremely hardworking. That is like your sabji. So in life, you should have every element to be successful. With all those things, you may not be successful. Again, what is success? What you feel inside is success. Not what people write or your biodata. You should feel nice about yourself. I got a chance. I did exceedingly well. I tried all my efforts and that's what I can do. That is called success. Not Infosys success or my Attimabbe or all these awards or Padma Bhushan. They come. They may not come. Please remember, you should be always successful in not life. It is never, it's only in movie 3 hours movie. In real life, there are successes, there are failures. Repeated success makes a person arrogant. Oh, I can achieve it. I can do everything. No, you can't do everything. I can never be a good cook. That's my weak point. Repeated success makes a person arrogant. Repeated failures makes a person diffident. Oh, I can't do it. A good amount of success and a fair amount of failure makes you a mature person. Accept failures as it comes. Failures have come to everybody. It has come to Rama, it has come to Krishna, it has come to Jesus Christ. So many people, it has come because it's part of life. Accept it and turn every failure as a stepping stone in the ladder of success. Ships are meant to be, ships are always safe in the harbor, but they are not meant to be there. Similarly, in life, you have to take risk, go around, make new friends, be seeker of knowledge. Don't be seeker of money, be seeker of knowledge, money follows you. When you are seeker of money runs away from you. Be a seeker of knowledge. See, seeker of learning. Seeker of excellence. Seeker of your passion. Seeker of your courage. And be compassionate. Because you are a human being. If you are not a human being, then compassion does not matter. The difference between an animal and a human being are 3. Number 1, we can stand on 2 legs. Number 2, we can express, talk our emotions. Number 3, we can be compassionate. If you do not have this, then you are not a human being. First 2 are natural. 3rd one you have to develop. school plays an important role in your life. You come with a sugar cane to school with all your assignments and your deadlines. They will crush you. But when you come out after 12th standard, you are ready-made sugar. To become sugar, you require crushing machine. And crushing machines are deadlines, examination, mock exam, instant exam. All these are needed. They're part of life. Remember your school, because school touches your heart. I remember my teachers fondly even now. I had a mathematics teacher by the name of Veronica. He was fantastic. When I was in school, he said, Kulkarni, tie your hand at the back, like this, fold your hand at the back. Then he will put a rider, okay, in geometry. And he said, there is no pen, pencil, you can't use because your hands are at the back, you solve it. I used to really get upset. Why he doesn't tell anyone and only me doing this? And then, you know, in those days, we can't talk to teachers back, it was just not allowed. Even now, I just say, you should not, you know, talk back, but you can ask questions. He said, Kulkarni, you must do this. And I used to solve. And every day this was fun at the end of the class. I remember him because whatever rank I got in my life, it was because of him. My mental ability to solve the problem without pen and paper, he developed that, which is a rare thing. Today you talk about Vedic math, Russian math, any math. But in a place like Hubli, in a school, a teacher taught me, if your mind is strong, you can do what is in the denominator, what is in the numerator, you can understand. You can solve without using pen and paper. And that helped me a lot in imagining three dimension, four dimension, because the sense of imagination grew. And it's important, teachers, you have to tell your children using computer, using calculator is not life. Brain, sharpening your brain is most important, and that gives you a kind of calculator in your mind. You can approximation, we call a theory of approximation, that you must learn. It will help you to know the depth, width of the problem, and understanding the situation. I always believe in the shloka, because I come from a teacher's family. For me, teaching is extremely pious and important profession in life. In olden days, somebody asked Arjuna, oh, warrior Arjuna, you are a prince, you are so much money, you have a beautiful wife, but you are always sitting in the feet of your teacher Drona, who is after all not a rich man. Tell me why. He said, in life, na dhanam, na kanakam, na rajyam. He went on telling, nothing remains with you. If you are beautiful after 25 years, people can't recognize you. If you have money over a period of time, if you don't invest properly, you will lose. But what remains with you forever is knowledge. And the person who gives knowledge is your teacher. And teacher, the more he gives or she gives, the more richer or more better teacher they are. First, you are an ordinary teacher. Second, you are a better teacher. Third, you are a good teacher. Fourth, you are an excellent teacher. Fifth year, you are teacher for life. You have an important position in a student's life. That's the reason in Taittiriya Upanishad, they say, the most important people in one's life is, of course, a mother, Matrudevo Bhava. Second person, father, Pitrudevo Bhava. Third person in one's life, when they are teenager like this, children, it is the teacher, Acharya Devo Bhava. You have a responsibility to mold their mind, to give them good values. And you are third in the hierarchy. We may not speak Sanskrit today, but nature has made that the role of a teacher is the most important role in a student's life, particularly in high school, school and high school. College, it's a contract life. You come to the class, I will give you attendance. Somebody will, you know, also give you a proxy, but still you will get attendance. And I have done my duty. Teaching, when I used to teach MCA or MSc, or MBA class, responsibility was less. Go and teach and come back. Don't worry about the results. When I used to teach PUC level classes, I know I used to get more tens than them, how they have done, performed. They got scared in the examination or what. Teaching the lower classes, particularly if someone is teaching LKG and UKG, I salute them. It's so hard. But teaching them up to 12th class is not easy. And teachers, I salute you that you have made a mark in their career, in their life, and their school days. Thank you very much. You gave me an opportunity to talk to you. If time allows, I can go on quoting, telling stories. I used to teach for an hour. Out of that 45 minutes, I used to teach computer science. Pascal, Java, C++, whatever it is. Remaining 15 minutes, I used to tell a story related to that. My students have done very well in life. Most of them are entrepreneurs in different countries. And when they come and meet me, old memories, old friends, old wine, and old students are precious and rare. I always agree for that. When I meet them, I said, beta, I taught you C++, Java. Tell me which was useful to you. They said, ma'am, none of them. To be honest with you, your stories. We'll recreate the same stories. Tell our children, my teacher taught this story. We had fantastic story sessions. If you give a sermon, satyam, vada, dharmam, chara, you should be straight, you should be honest, this isn't, the children will think it's a moral science class, they will sleep. Always moral science class will have two doors, okay? Entrance, exit, okay? But if you convert the same problem into story, they will stay back. Teachers, convert the difficult thing into a story. Students, remember the story and tell your children. It is always a pleasure to talk to children. Because I am a setting sun, you are a rising sun. It's so beautiful. I pray God, let your path be full of good things and some difficult time which you can manage. I pray God, your confidence should not come down. I pray God, lead full life. You are going to the new journey of life. No more uniform. You can wear whatever you want. Girls, particularly. Boys will have only pant and shirt, okay, not much. The new life, the new path of your journey, be nice to you. You learn many things in your new path. And I say the last word, which is taught in Upanishad, Shubhasthe Pantanu. O traveler, you are leaving my house and you are going away. I may meet, I may not meet. I'm always with you in your mind and spirit. Let this journey, which you are going to take next, should be useful to you, useful to mankind, and may you bring peace to everyone. Thank you very much. Dhanyavaad. Children, you should excuse me. I want to leave.
Thank you, ma'am, from the entire school community, as you were one of the best chief guests that we could imagine. Your life and works have been a true inspiration to us. Many of us wish to emulate your life principles and practices. Your words today have touched us. We are indebted to you for many reasons. Despite your extremely busy schedule, you decide to make time for our students. You are a matter of pride for us for upholding the right values and promoting the best practices of our culture. Proud godparent for thousands of children whom you have educated, entertained, or taken care of. Not only are we happy that you have played an instrumental role in setting up institutions, which has provided employment to the multitude and also been an inspirational parent. On a lighter note, every Indian is historically glad that you're the proud mother-in-law of the British Prime Minister. How often can this happen in the history of colonization? On a more serious note, you have inspired our students to set the goals and achieve it. Thank you. I hope that is going to be a big inspiration for all our students. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your invaluable experiences and inspiring us to make the right choices to add value to our lives and the community.
As part of our tradition, we now have some of our best young musicians from the graduating class performing for us. We welcome on stage our own star performer, Nanda Nair, enchanting us with her melodious singing, ably supported by Sriram Seshadri on piano, as they present to us Somewhere Only We Know by Keane.
somewhere only we know.
Thank you, Nanda and Sriram, for that captivating performance. Thank you, class of 2023, for your creative contributions to this school.
We now move on to the eagerly anticipated event of the awarding of the graduation certificates, mementos,